Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Cybersecurity Matters podcast. My name is Christian, and this is my awesome co-host, Mr. Dominic Vogel. Dominic, who do we have in the virtual hot seat today?
Today we're speaking with Mark Metry. He is I'm not even sure how to characterize him. He is a man of many, many talents. He's a best-selling author, the book Screw Being Shy. He's a top 100 podcast host, man of many talents. And I think there's going to be a lot of interesting conversations and threads that we'll be chatting with him today.
Let's get into it. So we're going to bring Mark on and we'll be right back.
Mark, we are so humbled to have you on our show today. Thank you so much for taking time out of your, what I'm sure is a really busy day. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Of course. Thank you guys so much for having me on this super, this is the best remote show I've been on.
Thank you for that.
There's
that kudos. Yeah, we appreciate that.
Yeah, we can't take credit for it. We have an awesome
production team for that. Absolutely.
So let us.
Good job, production team.
Yeah, absolutely. So we'll give a shout out to them. So let's get into your story, Mark, for those in the world that have been under a rock and have no idea who you are or know very little. Your parents immigrated from Egypt, I believe, way back in the 1990s. and back when, even before you were born, I think. So tell us about your family of origin and your life story. Start from the beginning.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Well, thank you guys for having me on. And for me, my parents came from Egypt and we immigrated to the U.S., to America, on the East Coast in Massachusetts. And, had a very, very simple, lifestyle, I would say. My parents came here with $200. We very much lived on government assistance, and it was just a very kind of simple childhood. Nothing too crazy happened. For me, where things kind of took a turn was by the time I was about 10, 11 years old, we had switched schools and I started to live in this small town with 5,000 people. And basically, this small town had definitely a small town mentality bubble, and nobody looked like me. There was no diversity whatsoever, and so I remember facing a lot of racism as a kid, a lot of physical, mental abuse, and that for me was kind of a time where I began to develop social anxiety, which really meant that just kind of retreated from the world, stopped talking. Became very, very anxious, could never talk, placed a lot of boundaries around my life. And so I've had that, but then also I've always kind of been an entrepreneur. And personally for me, I kind of had my first successful little online venture when I was 15 years old. Totally changed my lifestyle, totally changed what I saw in life was possible. And I've always kind of been doing that. And kind of recently, I've, started to kind of speak up about social anxiety and mental health because, I host a podcast, Humans 2.0. It's top 100 in the world. I interview leaders from many different walks of life. And, after I kind of went through my life story, which was, kind of becoming really successful, but then falling into many different mental health and other issues in life and deciding that, success is not the number one thing, or at least society's definition of success. And there really needs to be a more focus on almost kind of the more invisible things that we don't really necessarily see from our eyes, but affect many different areas of our society, like mental health, like how someone's brain is operating, their mindset, their psychology, kind of what's under the hood. Mm-hmm. And so after kind of going through my story of becoming successful, but then becoming depressed, obese, always had anxiety. Eventually at one point I was suicidal, and then hosting my podcast and speaking to people from the co-founder of Netflix to various billionaires that are hey, I had hundreds of millions of dollars in my bank account, but my brain was still very much hurt and broken. And so that's just really led me to kind of like take my platform, take like a lot of what I'm doing with my life over like the last few years and really try to orient it towards bringing awareness and speaking up around these topics. And I like wrote a book called Screw Being Shy. Mm-hmm. I host my podcast. I do a lot of different things, but that's really like, you know, what I'm here to do on planet Earth.
That is so awesome, Mark. It's so great. It just feels so like we've it's known genuine. Each other for a while. It's a very different flavor in a such a good way to some of the other interviews that we've had. So who inspires you, whether it's, you know, one of these well-known guests that you have had on your show, or who are your top inspirations?
You know, honestly, I think for me, when I look at my top inspirations, I think of people like, you know, my parents. Mm-hmm. I think of people that like came before me, you know, because I've been thinking about it. And, you know, we all have struggles in life. And, you know, as much as you have to go through the struggles, you know, just recently I've been thinking about like how I got to where I am. And a lot of that has obviously been my own work, my own decisions, kind of my own time that I spent when nobody was telling me what to do. But a lot of it has to do with, you know, when you're born into some sort of a society. And that society has been built on years and years and years and years of various problems and solutions and perspectives. And to me, I get really inspired by the people that tried to like build a society or like a civilization before me, because I know that if they didn't do that, then I don't know, maybe we'd be better off, but we probably wouldn't. And so those people really inspire me. And honestly, you know, in terms of the podcast, you know, for me, I really started my own podcast as a like my own personal self-development tool where I could just get in contact with a lot of really smart people much smarter than myself, and just learn from them and ask them just questions one-on-one. And so there's so many people that have inspired me throughout the podcast. And, you know, I started my podcast when I was 20 years old. And honestly, when I look back and look at all the episodes, you know, 500 plus, wow. I just see like, every several episodes or like every 50 episodes or whatever, I like remember like experiencing like a personal change in my own life. And it's just so crazy to look back at now that I can't really quantify it, because that would take, it's not possible.
That is so cool. I think what it amounts to for us is we need to get your parents on here.
Yes.
As guests. So let them know we need to have them on the show.
The thing too, Mark, with you and I've learned so much from your posts, and I love being engaged with your content on LinkedIn. Like a heartfelt thank you for, you know, all the amazing content that you post thanks, daily. Man. You know, it's truly inspiring, and you know, I appreciate, you know, how you advocate for mental health and do so in a way in which you're not coming from a prescriptive or like a doctor approach to anxiety. Because, you know, both my mom. Yeah, no, but I appreciate you coming not from that spot, because, you know, my wife and mom, you know, they both have suffered from mental illness during the course of their life. And, you know, when you go to a doctor, yes, there's an element to that which is important, but you never solve that full part there by going to a doctor. And a lot of what you have put out there has helped to really fill that void, and has helped both of them, and has helped me better, you know, communicate to them and understand them. So, you know, on that regard, like I said, I genuinely appreciate all that you do there. And one of the things which I definitely want to spend some time talking on is about systemic racism. You know, and you know, we're very much seeing that come to the surface again right now, in which, again, racism has never gone away in North America. It's been here since the beginning, and now we're at another boiling over point. And for me, what I would love to better understand, because, you know, at the end of the day, both Christian and I, we're middle-aged white guys. I've never experienced any form of discrimination, you know, and it's very, and I've said this in a recent LinkedIn post, in which, you know, people like me, we've actually been part of the problem because I haven't done enough to educate myself. I haven't done enough to understand that, you know what, this stuff is happening. And by not saying something or not giving people the right platform, I'm being part of the problem, not being part of the solution. So from your purview, again, from someone who has experienced racism, what are things that people can do to actionably take steps to, you know, one block at a time, take down systemic racism?
Yeah, so, you know, for me, I'm not like African American, I'm not black, but I'm definitely a person of color. And yeah, I mean, I remember experiencing racism every day of my life. And I think the craziest part about it is, you know, today I receive, because of what I do, I receive messages from people who like grew up with me, who went to school with me. And they're usually people who were pretty friendly to me, never really made fun of me, but were always sort of spectators mm-hmm. in what was going on. And so I'm like, I get messages all the time of people saying like, oh man, I can't believe this happened to you and I was right there and I could have done something. And so that to me has been a really interesting observation to kind of see. And this was happening before, you know, the recent, June 2020 civil rights protests. But I mean, I think number one is obviously I'm not an expert in this by any means. I'm just kind of like seeing what's happening and like talking to people who are involved in it and just trying to learn myself. But I think obviously one is you take care of like your own individuality in terms of like, you know, I think one of the most powerful things that I've understood in my life is that the human mind is so powerful that it can normalize anything. And I remember I learned that after, you know, going through anxiety and racism for most of my life, but never actually knowing that it was anxiety or it was racism. And I remember I really understood this when one of my friends, Donald Sujo, who is a world Olympian, he told me he grew up in a communist country, like way back. And he told me that when he was living in that communist country, he had no idea that it was a communist country. Mm-hmm. And that's because, again, your brain will normalize whatever it sees around you most commonly. And so that's the thing you have to keep in mind, and that you could be faced, whether it's racism, whether it's something else, you could be in these dynamics and not even know it. And so, of course, like, you know, trying to learn as much as you can about like how things actually work. Like I remember on Netflix, for example, I saw this, I don't know if you guys have seen it, but it's this documentary. It's like this movie documentary. I believe it's called When They See Us. Mm-hmm. And it's about the Central Park Five in New York City and what happened in the 80s, where basically five black 14-year-old kids were accused of raping and killing a lady. And the police knew that it wasn't them, but they literally locked them in jail for the rest of their lives. And they went through the most insane like psychological torture from mm-hmm. obviously being minors in prison to like mm-hmm. being viciously interrogated by the government and the FBI. And so I think one is like each person needs to be aware of like their own level of awareness of like their own life, their environment, how other people go through life. And then I think number two is that, you know, I don't know what it's like in Canada, but the system in the United States, especially in terms of the government, obviously, like every government, every system in the world is extremely flawed. And it's flawed in the sense of just the right problems are not being fixed. And so sort of like what's happening today with the protests and the various riots that are actually like creating change. People have always been thinking this since forever. But whether it's due to, you know, the maybe economic instability due to COVID, people really not trusting the government anymore, at least in America, people are basically like, and then we've been seeing, you know, the various like murders basically that have been done by people who have basically sworn to take an oath to protect their communities. But now because of video cameras, we can see it happening. And so a lot of it, what needs to change is people need to start voting for the right people. The amount of the amount of racist people like senators that we have in our government is insane. And they you can actually economically test this based on which money they get donations from which organizations, and seeing how they have impacted their community in terms of racism. And so that's the most important thing. And the biggest thing about this is it's not about the left or the right or being a Democrat or Republican in America. It's really the fact that you need to understand that there are certain people in each of these parties that are forward thinking and will try to help their people in the community, and there are people who are backwards for humanity, to be quite frank. And, you know, what I'm seeing today in the U.S. in terms of how our government is reacting to this, where, you know, if there's a problem that's happening, usually you're supposed to have a conversation about it to try to fix this issue. But instead, we're seeing, you know, everyone is really protesting, not just about Black Lives Matter, not just about systemic racism, but we're also protesting how the fact that we have seen our rights, and especially in marginalized communities like African Americans, like people of color, where we see that come out in our society the most. And so the reality is our system completely needs to change. And, you know, Martin Luther King has this quote, and he says, your budget, like a budget is in like at your organization, mm-hmm. or in the government, a budget is a reflection of where your moral priorities are. And so the reality is like, especially in America, where we have so much money for weapons and guns and just things that can, you know, obviously protect, but also destroy. And then you see, like, for example, what happens like when COVID-19 occurs, like just it did a couple months ago, where literally you have nurses and doctors and literally essential workers literally not have enough money to afford the most basic protective supplies for their lives. And so we're seeing this all play out right now, and it's all signifying of a major change. And there are major branches, there are major roots to this. One of it is the fact that, yeah, systemic racism. Our entire country, our entire government has been built on basically African Americans. And so all of a sudden, really, when you look at civil rights in general, when that happened in 1960s, that when I look at that and the fact that happened so recently in terms of human history, yeah, blows my mind. And this is just part of us removing the rest of those roots that are still there and really changing things, because, you know, we can definitely make things better. So I think there's that individuality piece of like kind of looking at your own mind, your own heart. And then there is getting out there and changing the government, changing the structures of how we do things. Or it's also this changing the structure of like your organization if you run a business. And so, again, I think it goes back to that Martin Luther King quote of like, a budget is an indication of where your morals and where your priorities in life are really at. And, you know, you can tweet whatever you want to all day, but at the end of the day, there's going to be real change that's going to have to come. And that is definitely reflective of how us as a society, we use our money and what we feel more than other things, because that really means we view them as important or not. So yeah, I hope that was an interesting answer. What do you guys think?
Absolutely. No, and completely agree with you there, Mark, in terms of those priorities and how that reflects itself in society. And one more quick question there before we let you go is, you know, still that fundamental nature here in which we need to see more people be more respectful and kind to one another. You know, when you look at some of these, even trying to have constructive dialogue around racism, you know, you get these, you can't have constructive dialogue because you get these polarized opposites. So how can we go about encouraging more people just to be, at the end of the day, be more kind to one another, be more human to one another, that we don't need to be name-calling each other or, you know, coming from a place of hate? How do we move towards a center where we're actually having constructive dialogue?
Yeah, and that's it. It's the center. And, you know, usually speaking in politics, in any system, there's a left and the right, and they're there to balance each other out, to try to be in that center and to move forward. But honestly, I don't know for what, but I think for whatever reason, at least in America, they had become so polarized where there is no middle ground anymore, where it's on the left side, there's like this entire culture of fighting with each other. And if you look at the right and you begin to see what's happening there, that is very much, obviously I'm generalizing, but that's very much becoming a lot of conspiracies, I think, are becoming to sort of get hijacked on the right. And when you look at the left of our society, you could debate and see if that's even better, if they're even doing a better job. And so I think these two sort of polar opposites, that whether it's due to social media, whether it's due to people saying whatever they want to now, they have totally become polar opposites, and it's hard to meet in the middle. And so I think the biggest thing that we need to do is we need to find ways as a society to automatically just get it in people's heads that we need to expand our awareness, and we need to be able to see how the person next to us sees the world. And I mean, you could do this in many different ways. This is already starting to happen. You could do this through movies, through music. I think a powerful one is like areas of like technology, where people can maybe see films or apps or like virtual reality, where you can literally see someone and how they live in their footsteps. And I think once you're able to see something like that, then, you know, as long as you're not like someone who's completely heartless, once you go on for the rest of your life, you have that into account. You know, it's impossible to like watch a documentary, that like one that I mentioned, If They See Us, and not really, you know, go back to your original worldview of like, there are no problems with the police, racism doesn't exist, people are just saying it because they're complaining, and this and that narrative. And so, yeah, I think that's the biggest thing. I think we just need to expand our level of awareness. And like, for example, we are now doing that through like podcasts, you know, like you guys live in Canada, we probably would have never been able to meet some other time, but now, you know, you're talking to some 22-year-old that's living on the East Coast of the United States, and you're learning about my view, and you're like, wait, what did he even say? And then people listening to your show might be thinking the same thing. And I think the most important thing is like, it's all about learning from each thing, and not trying to like believe in it or trying to like think it's trying to brainwash you. You know, it's all about listening to something and then critically thinking about that from your own perspective and saying like, you know, I agree with that, but I don't really agree with that. Let me try to take some of these things that I do agree with so we can meet somewhere in the middle and have these conversations, rather than just trying to pretend that you're right and everyone who opposes you is like a terrible person, or they're somehow brainwashed, that's or really they're good. This and that. And so I think that the answer is empathy. I'm not necessarily sure how we can like, you know, make this mainstream, but I think it's already happening with the way that like technology and like marketing is starting to change and so on and so forth. So yeah, I think that's the most important thing, like trying to see someone's life from someone else's point of shoes. That's super, super important.
Mark, we're so grateful to you for sharing your wisdom, your thoughts, and for this dialogue and this conversation. This is absolutely incredible, and I can definitely say this with the utmost confidence that it's amazing, kind people like you that fill me with great hope. That I think that we can all hopefully together create a beautiful tomorrow. So thank you again so much for your time, and thank you again for everything that you've been doing. Very appreciative of you being on the show today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mark.
Of course. Of course. Thank you guys so much for having me. You guys are great hosts. And you guys, again, this is like the most professional virtual podcast I've ever been on. You guys crushed it.
Awesome, Mark. Thank you so much. And Christian and I are going to be right back after these messages just to wrap things up on today's show.
Dominic, unexpectedly, what an awesome dude Mark is. It just feels like you're talking to your friend.
I know.
You know, and I think what stood out to me really was his life story. Mm-hmm. And, you know, asking the question, who influenced him the most in his life? Yeah. And I was thinking with all, like Ed Mylett and Gary Vaynerchuk and all these awesome people that he's had on his podcast, I'm thinking it's going to be one of those. Yeah. It was his parents. Yeah. So I'd love to love to get to know his parents.
Absolutely. No, it's truly remarkable for someone who's just 22 years old, what he's accomplished and the mindset that he has. You know, it's like I told him, I think that people like him give me great hope that, there can be a brighter tomorrow. So it was really interesting. A lot of the topics we talked about, you know, systemic racism and what people can do about that during this time. Just a really very warm, genuine human being. So for people who aren't connected with him on LinkedIn or following him on LinkedIn, please do so. He shares incredible content on a daily basis.
Yeah, I really hope we can have Mark on again.
Absolutely.
So thanks for watching, everybody. You can check out our other podcasts on conversationsthatmatter.tv, or you can listen to us wherever you normally listen to your podcasts. And we will see you next week.